existing RAF bases near Cambridge were used until new ones could be built. But by the end of the war, a total of 55 bases would be built for use by the 8th Air Force. The first units to arrive were the 97th, 301st and 92nd Bombardment Groups. Over the next 3 years, no fewer than 44 separate bomber groups would serve with the 8th Air Force in their operations over Europe. At its peak, a total of 41 bomber groups would serve at the same time. The amounts of aircraft available to the 8th increased slowly at first as the invasion of North Africa drew away reserves, but after this, aircraft became available at a much faster rate. By the early part of 1944, the 8th had 2,000 aircraft on hand. By late 1944, there were more than 3,000. It would eventually reach a number of 3,500, and their effective range from the bases in England could take them to Berlin and beyond if needed. As the air war escalated, it became clear that assaults would need to be mounted from places other than Britain in order to attack the southern reaches of the Reich. North Africa was considered, but abandoned once the Allies had gained a foothold in Italy, the perfect base for the newly formed US 15th Air Force, which was born on November 1, 1943. A total of 23 Italian bases were used during the war, the majority being constructed around the towns of Foggia and Cerignola. The 15th US Air Force was put under the command of Lieutenant James Doolittle, who was succeeded by General Nathan Twining. Consisting of more than 1,600 aircraft at its peak, the 15th attacked targets in Romania, Hungary, and southern areas of the Reich. Raids which further stretched Germany's resources. Despite the unfriendly climate and the additional hazard of the Alps in northern Italy, the pilots of the 15th played their full part in the eventual Allied victory. It was in the early part of May 1940 that Britain delivered its first bombing attacks on Germany. These attacks were small, but significant. They demonstrated Britain's willingness to forego any moral constraints and accept that civilians would be killed. At that stage of the war, no other country had taken such a step. Germany was quick to condemn the attacks and set out to deliver a response. The target chosen was the Dutch port of Rotterdam. The attack was ferocious and demonstrated the extent of Germany's bombing capabilities against a poorly defended target. The Luftwaffe continued its bombing campaign during the Battle of Britain until finally Britain achieved victory over Hitler's Air Force. However, Britain's victory over the Luftwaffe in the summer of 1940 merely allowed her to stay in the fight against Nazi Germany. The real difficulty lay in deciding what form that fight would take, for the loss of so much equipment during the disaster at Dunkirk and the losses suffered during the Battle of Britain severely limited Britain's offensive options. Churchill was keen to show that Britain still had fight left in her, and with the help of the Air Ministry, the fight back began. Even as Britain was fighting for her life in August 1940, Bomber Command sent a raid all the way to Berlin, the heart of Nazi Germany. Throughout 1940, there were tit-for-tat bombing raids by Britain and Germany on each other's home soil, while the Royal Air Force attacked areas other than Berlin, with the main target being Germany's oil supply. These attacks were widespread, but they were inaccurate and sporadic. Initially, Bomber Command had conducted the raids during daylight hours, but the losses were too high to allow this to continue. In some cases, the bomber formations lost up to half their number. The switch was made to nighttime attacks in an attempt to reduce the losses, but the Luftwaffe introduced its use of night fighters, who continued to inflict terrible losses upon the bomber formations. During 1940, there were no less than three changes in leadership at Bomber Command. Ludlow Hewitt was replaced by Portal in the early part of 1940. Portal was then promoted and replaced by Piers. These changes in command, along with the enforced change of targets, were a certain indication that things were not going too well for Britain in her attempts to bomb the enemy. 1941 saw further attempts by the British to improve their fortunes in the bombing campaign. In March, the target priority was switched once again, with more emphasis being placed on attacking German shipping installations and U-boat pens. This was an effort to try and curb the production of the U-boats and ships that were inflicting such terrible losses on the merchant ships bringing vital supplies to England. By the middle of 1941, German night fighters were becoming fully effective and were making their presence felt even more upon the bomber crews. The RAF were slowly beginning to select civilian targets more and more, as they failed to improve the accuracy of their raids. At the end of 1941, Piers would oversee the biggest raid of the war so far, when 392 planes attacked Berlin. But owing to the poor overall results, and with no hope of improvement, the raids were scaled back. Around the same time, a report into the effectiveness of the raids so far was published. The Butt report concluded that the raids were too inaccurate, and the cost to Bomber Command, both in crew and machines, was too high to justify their continuation. Britain was indeed entering her darkest period. At the end of 1941 and into 1942, the whole future of Bomber Command was under high-level discussion. The problem was that the British war effort, with its limited resources, was being stretched on all fronts. The one glimmer of hope was the entry of America into the war in December 1941. In the middle of February 1942, Bomber Command issued its highly controversial directive for the area bombing of the enemy homeland. It was decided that attacks would be made on selected, densely populated cities in an attempt to undermine the morale of the German home population. As the bombers still did not have the technology to deliver their bombs with greater accuracy, it was decided that this new tactic, area bombing, would be the most effective use of the bomber force. Other crucial decisions were made during 1942. One was the appointment in February of Air Chief Marshal Sir Arthur Harris to replace Piers. Encouraged by the introduction of new four-engine bombers with greater range and bomb-carrying capacity, Harris ruthlessly carried out Portal's area bombing directive. There was also the first use of combined Anglo-American raids on Germany, although there were some disagreements over the merits of nighttime and daytime raids. Despite the setbacks and enormous losses, Harris was determined to demonstrate the growing might of the RAF to the Germans. In May 1942, 1,000 bombers, a mixture of Lancasters, Wellingtons, Stirlings and Manchesters, took off with Cologne as their target. The 2,000 tons of explosives delivered that day caused widespread destruction and loss of life. Harris's message had been delivered with deadly clarity. Further raids were also carried out over Essen and Bremen. Despite these huge blows to the enemy, the cooperation with the Americans, the introduction of Pathfinder aircraft and the improvement of aircraft bomb sites, Allied losses continued to mount during 1942. In all, 1,400 aircraft were lost. Furthermore, the bomber offensive was placing a huge strain on the country's oil supplies. And although German High Command appeared to have been badly shaken by the bombing, civilian morale had not collapsed, and war production seemed unaffected. At the start of 1943, the Allied leaders held a conference in Casablanca where they agreed a number of decisive measures regarding the future conduct of the war. One was the decision to mount an intensive combined bomber offensive